Hello friends, welcome to Daily Editorial Enrichment Program presented by LAX R&D team. Today, we will discuss the editorials of October 9th, 2019. The first article that we'll be discussing today is Stirring Up the Truth About ZBNF. Here, ZBNF stands for Zero Budget Natural Farming. This particular article holds significance for GS3 paper, particularly for the subtopic Indian Agriculture. Recently, the government included ZBNF in its agricultural policy. Before we move on to the analysis of this policy decision, let us understand what ZBNF actually is. In ZBNF, the two words zero budget emphasizes agricultural practice where cost on purchased inputs is zero, and NF, that is natural farming, also emphasizes agriculture practice where farming with nature is given significance rather than use of chemicals to grow crops. The whole philosophy of ZBNF stands on the belief that soil has all the nutrients that plants need. In the method of ZBNF, they believe that microorganisms play an important part in transferring these nutrients to the soil medium. This is where we come across the concept of four wheels of ZBNF. In all these four wheels, that is Bijamrit, Jeevamrit, mulching and Vapasa, varying levels of cow dung, cow urine and other natural items such as tobacco, green chili, fruit are used. These formulations are used at different stages to achieve a purpose. Example, in Bijamrit, cow dung and cow urine are used for microbial coating of seeds. This is believed to be beneficial for the crop. Even in pest management, such formulations are used for the beneficial of crop production. Another thing that we have to keep in mind while reading this article is that there is a definite difference between ZBNF and organic farming. Most of the times, aspirants often confuse these two agricultural farming practices. In ZBNF, we do not use vermicomposting or red worms, while in organic farming, we use such methods. This is the whole underlying philosophy of zero budget natural farming. The authors in this particular article raise some valid concerns with respect to zero budget natural farming. The primary concern that they raise is that ZBNF does not actually reduce the cost on input, since many formulations under ZBNF are to be purchased. For example, cost of maintaining cows, wages of hired labor. Another concern that they point out is that there is no universal evidence on the benefits of ZBNF against other farming methods. The other concern that they raise is ZBNF provides a single method for nurture of soil everywhere in the country. This method is not scientific since the profile of soil varies across our country. In some areas, some nutrients might be in excess, while in some other areas, it might be deficient. ZBNF does not actually take all this into consideration. It gives one single solution for all of India's soil profile. Additionally, the nitrogen requirement of Indian soils are difficult to be met with ZBNF methods. What is the way forward then? The authors in this particular article suggest that we should rather concentrate on improving our soil health, and this should be the priority agenda in our agricultural policy rather than emphasis on ZBNF. Checking wind and water erosion of soil should also be given due emphasis in our policy. Minimizing physical degradation of soils due to water logging or flooding and even crusting is also required in the policy. The other thing that our policy should concentrate upon is location-specific interventions towards balanced fertilization and integrated nutrient management. And also, chemical fertilizers should be used wherever required in an appropriate manner rather than using them in abundance. To sum it all, the scientific temper should have been the main basis of forming the agricultural policy than ZBNF, for which there is no universal scientific evidence present at this particular point of time. Let us now move on to the next article, that is Rethinking Water Management Issues. This particular article holds significance for GS3 paper, particularly for the subtopic Environmental Conservation. It is no surprise that India is facing one of its major and most serious water crises in recent times. According to the Composite Water Management Index report released by the Niti Aayog in 2018, 21 major cities, which includes Delhi, Bengaluru, Chennai, Hyderabad and others, are racing to reach zero groundwater levels by 2020, which will affect almost 100 million people in our country. Niti Aayog, in one of its report titled Strategy for New India at 75, talks about how to use water resources in our country in an effective and efficient manner. However, the authors in this particular article argue that the water resource management given in the Niti Aayog report is not sufficient and is ill-suited to meet the water crisis that India will face in the coming days. The author argues that the present document, which talks about water crisis in Niti Aayog's report, takes no consideration of past failures, or it sets upon itself unrealistic goal, and more importantly, there is no accountability mechanism built in the document to ensure that the objectives are met in a timely manner. Let us now look into what exactly are the past failures that the author talks about. For example, adoption of integrated river basin management approach and river basin organization, as suggested by the document, has been a failed concept since many years. For example, India till today has not created any moderate size basin or even a river basin organization. Furthermore, recommendation to establish water resource regulatory authority is also flawed, since the existing ones have not achieved any true success. For example, there is such a regulatory in Maharashtra and its success rate has been very limited. The same logic has been applied for command area development without analyzing it for its past failures. Furthermore, the document does not fix any responsibility on institution for achieving the targets. Whatever objective we set will have a significant meaning if we can hold some institution responsible for it, either a central government institution or a state government institution, or a special purpose vehicle could have been set up to make sure that the objectives mentioned in the document could have been achieved. The author in this particular article also draws our attention to one of the major reforms that the document has overlooked, that is preventing the misuse of PIL. Most of the environmental projects in our country, for example, interlinking of rivers, has been stuck at various forms of judiciary, whether it be at high courts or supreme courts or even National Green Tribunal. The author emphasizes that if we prevent this blatant misuse of PIL, the water crisis of India can be to a certain extent effectively addressed in a timely manner. Significantly, the author in this particular article believes that India's water problem can be solved with existing knowledge, technology and available funds, rather than continuation of the past failed policies like the Niti Aayog report emphasizes on. Let us now move on to the next article, that is towards a strategic partnership. This particular article holds significance for our GS2 paper, particularly for the topic bilateral relations. Mexico and India have had a long history of diplomatic relationship. It has been 69 years since diplomatic relations between the countries was established. The relationship between these two countries is based on mutual understanding and beneficial interest. In 2007, a privileged partnership was established, and now both the countries are working towards coming up with a strategic partnership. This positive trajectory of growth between the relationship between the two countries has been because of the shared values between the two countries. What are these shared values? Let us have a look at it. The first shared value is both the countries have a common goal, that is social development and inclusion. Both Mexico and India are known for their welfare policies across the world. Another important shared value is their mutually beneficial interest in multilateralism and rules-based international system. In various United Nations forums and multilateral forums such as G20, they have often espoused the same cause of multilateralism and rules-based international system. Furthermore, both the countries have a strong commitment towards democracy. Another important facet of shared value between the two countries has been its thriving culture and diversity. Various steps have been taken by both the governments of the countries to ensure that this positive trajectory of growth is maintained between the two countries. For example, the promotion of trade and investment between the two countries has increased in recent times. High-level meeting between government officials has also been given due importance. Recently, both the governments are encouraging people-to-people links through tourism. The thing that we have to observe is that the number of tourists from India to Mexico has been gradually increasing. Both the countries in recent times have also explored the opportunity of cooperating in the field of space sciences. Whatever might be the steps we take in the future to further the relationship between the two countries, we have to always keep in mind that our goals are set and achieved in a mutually beneficial manner, and also in a manner which achieves our strategic purposes. For example, both India and Mexico can become the forerunners in ensuring that the globalization that was unleashed post-1991 is not diluted by developed countries, particularly from USA, where there has been a consistent effort to dial down the globalization that has been happening since past few decades. The next article that we are going to discuss today is regional disputes should be resolved through dialogue and consultation. This particular article corresponds to GS2 paper, particularly India-China bilateral relations. In this particular interview, the Chinese ambassador emphasizes the dimension of India-China relationship, particularly in the context of the second informal summit that is to be conducted in the district of Mamallapuram in the state of Tamil Nadu in coming days. The Chinese ambassador believes that the first informal summit that was conducted in Wuhan in China has achieved a large positive outcome in ensuring that there is positivity in India-China relationship. One of the outcomes that he talks about is that the mutual trust and friendship between the leaders has had a positive impact in engagement at other levels too. Furthermore, there has been a frequent high-level exchanges to ensure maximum convergence on issues of interest to both the countries. In recent times, both the leaders of India and China have nearly met 5 times. Such kind of high-level exchanges can minimize the tensions between the two countries. The positivity of Wuhan summit can also be seen in the recently concluded 6th Strategic Economic Dialogue and 9th Financial Dialogue. Here, both the countries emphasize cooperation in various fields such as infrastructure, energy conservation, environmental protection, high technology, energy and medicine. India has also had a long-standing problem with the growing trade imbalance which is in favor of China. In recent times, particularly after Wuhan summit, the Chinese ambassador says that various measures have been taken to ensure that this trade imbalance is reduced to a certain extent. For example, he says certain barriers on Indian imports have been reduced. Both India and China have their fair set of differences between them. For example, when it comes to Belt and Road Initiative, India has opposed it. However, such opposition has not affected strengthening solidarity and cooperation between the countries in other areas. For example, both the countries in recent times have espoused the cause of multilateralism. They have called for reforms in WTO and they have also taken up infrastructure in regional blocs such as BCIM. They've also cooperated actively in organizations such as Shanghai Cooperation Organization or even BRICS. Though India has a long-standing boundary dispute with China, the peace in the border regions have been maintained for a very long time. Even though China in recent times has taken the side of Pakistan in certain crucial issues which matter to India, such as listing of Masood Azhar or even its comments on revocation of Article 370, these differences have not held up the positivity that was established in the first informal summit that was conducted in Wuhan. One hopes that such positivity will ensure that there is a positive trajectory of growth in the second informal summit and also the coming India-China bilateral relationship. In coming days, the bilateral relationship between India and China will not just be limited to the South Asian region, but it will grow to have a global strategic significance, particularly when there are several policy makers who think that the 21st century will belong to Asia. Hopefully, informal summits such as this can achieve that objective. The last article that we'll be discussing today is A Life in the Balance. This particular article holds significance with respect to GS2 paper, particularly under the subtopic Multilateral Institutions. This particular article has been written in the context of the latest ruling of International Court of Justice in the month of July. As we all know that Kulbhushan Adab, a retired Navy official, was arrested by Pakistan on the charges of espionage and tried in Pakistan in an arbitrary and an unjust manner. India took up the case of Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav in International Court of Justice. The International Court of Justice deliberated on this particular matter and gave a ruling that Pakistan had indeed acted in an arbitrary manner in the case of Kulbhushan Jadhav. It stayed the execution of Kulbhushan Jadhav by the Pakistani court, and furthermore, it ensured that India gets consular access to its citizen. However, Pakistan has been dragging its feet in implementing the orders of International Court of Justice. For example, Pakistan only gave a single consular access for India to its citizen. Furthermore, when India asked for more consular access, Pakistan has been dragging its feet. It is not faithfully implementing the verdicts of the ICJ. In such a scenario, what is it that we should do? We should keep in mind that ICJ verdicts are final and without appeal. So, the author in this particular article argues that India should take a recourse to United Nations Security Council under the Charter. This particular UN Charter mandates that each member state of the UN should comply with ICJ's decision. If United Nations Security Council deems it necessary, it can make recommendation or decide the measures to be undertaken to give effect to the judgment of International Court of Justice. The author of this particular article also quotes the example of Nicaragua, where such a recourse was taken by the country. India should explore similar such options. It also has to make sure that it acts in a timely manner to ensure justice is done in this particular case. That is all for today's deep analysis. Thank you.